Hey folks, Kilt-Man here, Kilt-Man at your services. How are you all? I hope you're all doing very, very well. Now, I'm going to do something I haven't done for years on the channel. I'm going to review a mask. Yes, do you remember the good old days when Kilt-Man first got started? All I was doing was reviewing masks and stuff. Masks and merch and movies. That's the tagline of the channel, I think. It's something along those lines, anyway. So, we've got a mask today. No, it's not a brand new mask. It's been out for, a few years now. But I've only just picked it up. So, and what mask is it? It's a mask of a zombie from the classic 1978 George A. Romero masterpiece, Dawn of the Dead. Or to give it its English title, Zombies, Dawn of the Dead. And there you've got a mask there already from Trick or Treat Studios of Flyboy, of Steven. And it's a fabulous mask, that one. But that's one of my favourite masks of all time. Over there, we've got Scott H. Reiniger as Roger, when Roger Dodger comes back from the dead. I don't want to be walking around like that, you know. But he does come back. Doesn't get to walk around much, because Peter is Bezzy Mate, Super SWAT Team, Supremo Action Star. Ken Faree puts a bullet right between his eyes. Puts an end to any potential walking about like that. So, who have we got then? Did the check shirt perhaps give it away? Or even the title of the video maybe give it away? It is the airport zombie, otherwise known as the check shirt zombie. Also, a poster boy for Dawn of the Dead. I don't know if you can see around here now, there's some imagery from the poster, the American poster for Dawn of the Dead, and it's his head. Pretty much from sort of there, so there upwards, and he's there, like, just like that, and that's the poster. Now, the sequence in question is a fabulous, another set piece. Dawn of the Dead is just full of set piece mayhem, after carnage, after slaughter. Extraordinary battle scenes with bikers and custard pies and zombies riding around the shopping mall. It's incredibly visceral comic book stuff. Very lurid. But our heroes are hapless four survivors. Roger, Peter, the two SWAT team guys, Stephen and Fran, his girlfriend, who work at WGON, the TV station. They've done a runner in the station's helicopter, and they've gone across country, and you've seen all the rednecks enjoying themselves, just having target practice, shooting at zombies in the fields. It's a big cookout barbecue for them, just a bit of fun. And they realise they've got to stop for fuel. So they find this little provincial airport, just a little ramshackle thing, and they land there, and Roger's filling it up, like, as you do with your helicopter. And Peter goes in to investigate the control hut, and he gets a cup of coffee from the air dispenser. He's sitting there having that. Fran and Stephen go walk about, erroneously, as it turns out, to have a look in the hangar and see if there's anything they can salvage, just anything. But it's all junk, and they all get attacked by zombies who just happen to be in the vicinity. I mean, Peter hears this strange gurgling noise behind a door, and he fires a few shots through it. But of course, it's when the door finally opens, it's two little zombified kids. So the bullets he put through the door, they were underneath the bullets, you know. So he has to then kill these kids in another shocking scene. Fran and Stephen encounter zombies in the hangar, and a big sledgehammer, a big ball peen hammer gets smacked on one zombie's noggin. And Stephen, who's not the best of shots ever, tries to shoot several of the zombies, and he's just not much good at it. In the meantime, Roger gets menaced by Chop Top Zombie. The one he's got his head built up like Frankenstein's monster, and he's got no time to get his gun out, but the zombie climbs over the packing crates and puts its silly head right into the way of the rotor blades, and it's a great effect, and the zombie just slumps back down with the top of his head neatly sliced off. I wish Trick or Treat Studios would release that, because that'd be a great mask, wouldn't it? You know, with a flattened head and just the brains on show. Anyway, but another zombie appears, and it menaces Peter. After he's just shot the kids, suddenly this looms up. walking down the path towards the door of this control hut. But before, he's already expended an entire magazine, but before he can reload his M16, he sees there's Stephen right the way down the path with his hunting rifle. And we know how bad a shot he is. And Peter just knows he's in the direct line of fire. The zombies are in front of him, but those bullets coming through that zombie are gonna go through Peter as well. And this guy can't shoot for shit. So Peter has to leap all over the place as this guy gets pummeled with useless bullets through his chest. Another one. Oh, it's just like that. And we've already seen that Roger, that guy, can take over quite successfully from Stephen's inept shooting. And like, just get your rifle out of the way. And although he's a lefty, Scott H. Rowning is a left-handed shooter. And it always seems very strange when you see someone, because most weapon systems aren't built for people who are left-handed. They're just not. Some weapon systems are, but the M16 can be redone, remodified. But the way he brings up the rifle like that, and his left elbow is out at a really ridiculous angle, but he is the one who puts the successful shot through the back of this guy's head, and he just goes poof on the table like that, and then rolls off, leaving a little bit of strawberry jam brain tissue. And of course Peter's none too pleased and storms out and accosts Stephen, puts the gun on him like that, and Fran's going, Peter, what's the matter? Peter, what's wrong with you? You never point a gun at anybody, mister. Scary, isn't it? Isn't it? And the two of them kind of calm down. And they do become best mates. But interestingly, on the flight away from there in the helicopter, they're talking about, look, they've come away from Philadelphia. So like any of the big cities are out of the question. Anything like Philly, we may never get out alive, you know. But they're easy to get around these things. And like Peter just goes, it wasn't one of those things that almost blew me away. And Steven's like, with the joystick and all that. Because they need him, because he's the pilot, remember. But anyway, let's get back onto this. Alexander Ray for Trick or Treat Studios designed and sculpted this. And it is an incredibly accurate depiction of the actor Paul Musser, who played the airport zombie. Now, I'll take you on a tour of this. I hope you're getting the detail of that, the ravaged face and the sunken eye there, because this glistens. That's really fresh and raw, you know, a bit like that. I've enhanced that mask though quite a bit compared to when it first arrived, but this glistens really spectacularly well. I know I have no need to do any modifications on this mask at all. It's perfect as it is. Now, of course, Savini, who did the effects, Tom Savini, makeup effects and all the gore, he just gave, you know, all the zombies just an undercoat of like blue, or in some cases green or grey. That's very blue, that one. This is very grey, this one, for Paul Musser. And you've got the droopy eye, you've got all the ravaged flesh, and it looks fresh as well. You've got some nibbling down here, and because his shirt is ripped open and half of his chest seems to have been chewed away as well. And of course then he gets bullets through him as well. But that is the iconic look. If you look at the eyes, because I've seen pictures of the real guy himself, Paul Musser, and that is the exact colour of his eyes. It is spot on. There's a hole in that eye there, so you can see through it. And you can see through obviously this little gap here, where this droopy eye has gone sinking down the face. A bit like The Incredible Melting Man, where his eye, the one good eye he's got, finally just dribbles down his already melting, spongy face. That'd be a great mask as well, wouldn't it? But you might notice there's a slight depression here. And that's how it arrived. This arrived in a plastic bag. It wasn't in a box. When you get a mask and it arrives in a plastic bag, you're always like, oh no. But at least the postie didn't try to ram it through the letterbox. He literally knocked on the door, because there was a few other items as well. Not for me, hasten to add. And but I thought, oh no, it's gonna be all disheveled and knackered. But to be honest, that's the only thing slightly wrong with it. And that can be sorted out very easily anyway. And this will be sitting on a mannequin head, which will fill it out. But also you can just use a hairdryer and you can easily reshape that. So it's not an issue. But look at it. The face is realistic. You know, that side, it ain't so bad there, ain't so bad. But then you see that, oh shit. You've had a bad day, haven't you, mate? And it won't get much better for you either. Because you won't get to chew down on Peter. You're just going to get your brains blown out. Bit of blood on the ear there as well. And a bit of blood on that ear. And so you've got the ravaged bit down here, which clearly, that does look like bites there, doesn't it? You know, a big chomp's been taken out of him. And you've forgotten something. Cheers, y'all. So I'm playing Goblin Score for Dawn of the Dead. I've took out some of the crazier elements that Goblin did for the album, which are not in the movie. So it's just the movie stuff. But look at that. You can see, now in the film as well, you can see it, but it's not quite as apparent as it is here, where the skin's come away, the flesh has been ripped away, and you've got skull, you've got cranium there. That's fantastic, that. That it's so gnarly and nasty, but it's brilliant. Now, I'm gonna say something else as well. For many, many years, I thought that this zombie was a black man. That's what I thought. But he's not. Paul Musser is white. Makes no difference at all. But I thought, I've always thought he was black, but he isn't. In 2017, Paul Musser, who plays this zombie, was invited to the Monsterpalooza convention somewhere in America. And America gets all the best conventions, doesn't it? Monsterpalooza. And although he was sitting there and touted as being the airport zombie and people were queuing up for his autograph and pose for pictures with him, they did something else as well. They had some special effects makeup artists there who reapplied the makeup to copy how he looked in the movie live on stage. Now, although Savini did all this back in the day, Savini was there, but he didn't apply the makeup, but he supervised the entire makeup session. How cool would that have been? To watch the iconic poster airport zombie from Dawn of the Dead getting remade up in the makeup and then strutting around with obviously the correct plaid shirt. Now, I went out and bought this shirt specifically to wear with this mask. I had grandiose ideas of doing a big intro like I did when I was reviewing the mask for Steven Flyboy, and I put the shirt on and I was wearing a kilt. I wasn't wearing pants, I was wearing a kilt, as of course you'd expect. But I had that on, and I had a revolver hanging, dangling from my dead finger, and I came shambling into the gonk, you know, theme tune from the mall. And I thought, I'll do something like that for this. But I thought, he doesn't do anything. He literally just walks up the path, stands there with his arm outstretched, waiting for the bullet to hit him. And then he goes, oh, then gets hit again, and then his head hits the counter, and that's it. Doesn't do much else, so I couldn't really do a reenactment. And plus, I didn't get the right shirt either. The shirt he wears is very similar to the Wallace tartan. Now, that's not William Wallace tartan. William Wallace never wore tartan, didn't wear a kilt. But there is a Braveheart tartan you can get, which is just made to look like the one that's in the movie. But the Wallace tartan itself, it's red and black, but it's shot through with a bit of yellow, and it's gorgeous. But I thought, well, that's a kilt. I'll get the shirt. I haven't got any plaid shirts, you know. My tartan lives from the waist down. So I went out to Mrs. Kilt-Man and said, oh, the charity shop's in Liscard. You'll find one in there, no problem. So I did, I walked in, and within 10 seconds, I found this shirt. And stupidly, I went, oh, that's it, that's ideal. Bought it, came back, and discovered, of course, it's not the same tartan. You guys wouldn't need to have known any of that, but it's important to me. So, anyway, I will put the mask on. Trick or Treat Studios, Alexander Ray, sculpted design. I'm like a nun in a bonnet.
Whoa. Now his shirt's sort of wide open and his chest is all like really ripped up and that, like, but that's how he is. Not bad, is it? It's It's very realistic.
By the way, a little tip for you. If you've got long, straggly, shaggy, silly caveman hair like me and you put a mask on straight away, be careful, because if all the hair goes right over your eyes, you can't see a thing. It's in your nose, so you can't even breathe with the two little holes in the nostrils there. So it's a very suffocating affair when you've got a lot of hair in a mask. But yeah, look at it. It is fantastic, isn't it? I also thought that he had a goatee beard. A lot of prints of Dawn of the Dead are very, well, they're not the best, are they? It's an old movie. It wasn't shot with the best of cameras. And the colour scheme is a bit OTT. The blood often looks very orange as well, you know, and it's melted Crayola. That's how it looks. But that only serves the comic book feel of the movie. But from a technical standpoint, it doesn't look that good. Obviously, Savini really, really ramped up his abilities with Day of the Dead and Friday the 13th and I've got The Burning and Creepshow and many others, of course. But in what they lack in technical prowess in Dawn, they more than make up for in giddy, gory abandon, because there's so many gore gags, as they call it. They call them gags, all the effects. And it is non-stop. It's a cavalcade of gore and carnage. And each zombie has a unique look to it, which is why he became quite a celebrated zombie. But as we're saying, in the film itself, I thought he was black, and I also thought he had a goatee beard as well. And it's because of this, because the colour palette, the colour timing on the film isn't that great. It looks very black, like it's like he's got a goatee beard, a black goatee beard. I mean, he hasn't. It's just blood. It's just lots of smeary blood all around his gob. So it took getting the mask to make me realise a hell of a lot of stuff about that character. But it is a fabulous mask. Nice and thick. It's the standard of Trick or Treat Studios masks is always brilliant. I know I used to cover their stuff quite a lot. And there's only been a couple of instances where I've not really been that impressed. And the mask has needed further modification by my own fair hand. One of them being the big American Werewolf Kessler Wolf mask, which I really, really customised that and modified that. Put extra fur on it as well, because it had that kind of, that really horrible, pathetic, sort of straggly, I can't think what the word is, almost like wire sort of fur. So I put lots of my dog's fur on it as well, because I've got a husky, and she's quite generous with her off-cuttings, her sheddings, so there was no shortage of fur, real-life fur, to put on that thing. And I recoloured it as well, and it looks amazing now. This, there's no need to do a damn thing to this. It is absolutely perfect, apart from the little dinge there. But as I say, I can sort that out. That's not a major issue at all. It's the detail on it though. Look at all that. There's a hell of a lot going on there. It looks bloody awful and bloody spectacular at the same time. But it's that, the colours and the eyes and the realism. There's a life to some of these masks. Look at that. I've actually got a friend who looks like this. Well, that side. Not that side, but that side. He's bald as well, and he's got the same colour eyes. And so it is weird. It's kind of uncanny. If I look at it from this side, on the less wounded side, it's like looking at me, mate. And it is a bit bizarre. But look at it again. As I say, in the film, you don't quite see the skull, the broken skull, quite as apparently as you do on the mask. But it is there, it is in the film, so that is authentic and accurate. But again, it could be down to the lighting and the colour timing again, which obscures it perhaps. There's lots of, it's really three-dimensional, and you can put your fingers into all the wounds and all the grisly bits. It's just, what a lot of these masks don't seem to get right when it comes to blood is to make it look thick, redolent, really deep red and shiny. It's the shininess that you want to get from it. It glistens, and they have knocked it out the park with that, because that really is there. Because what I've done in the past with certain masks, to give them that glistening effect, is put a bit of hairspray or lacquer on it. It just super shines. Obviously that will dry off at some point, but it works for if you're going to go out trick or treating, or you're going to go to a party or whatever. That's a nice little tip to make it glisten for a while. Now you can always, give it a bit of a touch up throughout the session if need be. But this guy needs nothing going on. He just needs a better shirt, a more authentic bloody shirt. I'm sorry, I did get that wrong. And when I come back and I checked the scene out again, I went, oh God. And Mrs. Kilt-Man said, did you just go to the one charity shop? And I went, yeah, because there's loads in this car. There's about six or seven charity shops. And I went, yeah, just the watches. And I bet you would, if you'd gone anywhere else, you'd have found the proper one, wouldn't you? Well, didn't I feel the putz then? Yeah. Well, not entirely, because after I bought the shirt, I went straight to the Royal Oak and sat there with my new shirt and lots of whiskey. So I felt like, hey, I've achieved something today. Yes, I bought the wrong shirt. But look at that. Look at that. That is great, isn't it? Trick or Treats have also released the Hare Krishna zombie. And again, I think he has more of the blue look of that one. But I don't want it. Although he's quite an iconic zombie as well. He's the one because they're hidden away in the attics, the loft areas of the mall, and Roger and Peter are doing their little recon around the shopping mall, and Steven's stupidly gone and left Fran all alone up there, and he's going into the generator room, and he's still trying to, he wants to do something as well, and but he's left her alone, and when all the other zombies get distracted by Roger and Peter to lead them away from their little, the door leading up to the loft area, the Hare Krishna one turns around and goes back, and he goes up the stairs and menaces Fran. But our boys get back in time and manage to put the rifle butt into his skull. You don't see that. The butt just hits the camera like that. But you know that they've offed him. But the mask is incredibly lifelike. But it's just a Hare Krishna head. Just because we know who it is, I wouldn't want that on display. Nothing against Hare Krishna, not at all. But it's not a horror mask to me, even though it is a zombie. But anyway, but this guy definitely nails it. So I'd love to see one with the chopped off helicopter blade. That'd be great, wouldn't it? And which biker is it? Is it Tiso Stavrakis who was one of the team special effects makeup artists for Tom Savini, and is in many George Miller movies. He's the one who gets his head ripped off in Day of the Dead, with the fingers going into his eye sockets, and hauling his head off like a bowling ball. Well, he's one of the bikers in it, and I think he's the biker who, he comes off the back of the bike and all that, he's lying there, and the zombies all converge on him, and one of them takes a huge chunk out of his neck, but it's a curious scene, because it's not spurt and blood, it takes a bite out, and it looks like cheese, a great big chunk of white cheese, and it's, even though it's quite bizarre, it's really unpleasant to look at. So I don't know, I love the severed arm as well, because you've got one of them, in fact it is this one, you keep wanting to put money in the blood pressure machine for some unknown reason. The zombies are everywhere, like bikers, his comrades are being shot down, and he still finds time to put a coin in this thing, to put his arm in the not blood transfusion, blood pressure thing. And then the zombies converge on him and he gets that big thing ripped out of his neck. But you see his arm later on, the arm that he put through for the blood pressure. I'd like a prop of that arm as well, if you please. But look at that. Curiously, there's no smell to this mask as well. Sometimes you get, you get that latex smell. There's no smell with this. I mean, that's just this. If you get this mask, you go, oh God, it stinks. Well, hey, hard cheese. But this one, there's no smell at all. I've had masks, you know, for decades in some cases, and some that smelled when I first got them still smell now to this day. They just have this pungency. And then you get a mask that don't have it at all, and this is one that doesn't have it. Well, certainly not this one here. But it is outstanding, and it's still widely available. So if you ain't got it, I do recommend it. Alexander Ray, as I say, did the sculpting on it, and the paint work is phenomenal. The paint job, that is uncanny. I'll show you that one in a minute, so you can see the difference in the sort of colour scheme on the skin. But having watched it again, that is correct. It's a lighter sheen than his. His sickly blue, sort of, congealed turquoise sort of colour that you got on him. This is grey, or a very pale blue sort of thing. And of course, it was a wax, derma wax and latex that Savini used. It was primitive stuff, and he learned some copy from Dick Smith and other makeup artists, but he used a lot of derma wax and stuff, and the more you put onto a face, the more you can cut into it, obviously. So a lot of cases, and Savini learned this quite early on, you need people who've got a bit more on them, so you can put more makeup on in the first place. So, and then you can cut, oh no, sorry, I've got that wrong way around. You need people who are a lot thinner than they appear in the movie. If they're thinner and skinnier, you can put more makeup over them, and then you can really rip into it. And of course, Rick Baker worked that out for American Werewolf, where you've got Jack Goodman, Griffin Dunn, who's ripped to hell. Sort of, and I've got that mask as well, which is outstanding. But you can do more with it, you can rip into it more, because the real flesh is still way beneath all the layers of latex and prosthetics. So let's just put him down for a second and I'll show you this guy. And he's sitting on a bottle of whiskey. Here's Flyboy. That is, I love that, because they've got that expression on his face. And now you can see the blood and the wound are glistening. Now, I did that. I have massively embellished this because it was a bit more anemic looking, and I've also given more shadow to it, because he has got more sunken in cheeks when he comes back from the dead, and also the black around, the darkness around the eyes. So that's more screen accurate, I think. And again, let's just get the two of them together so you can see the different colour scheme. So grey, quite clearly grey. Looks green, doesn't it? Actually looks green, but it's not, it's blue. Look at it. It's outstanding. I love that. I love this mask. And again, talking about like actual makeup effects, even to this day, after saying that some of the effects, a lot of the effects in Dawn are a lot more primitive when you compare to what you'd see in Day of the Dead and later Savini, you know, gore classics. But when Steven turns around and begins to lead the zombies towards the hideaway, because he remembers where it is, and he turns around and you see that huge gaping hole in his throat, even to this day, that I'm like, how did he do that? It looks like it's really gone in. Well, I've explained how he did it. You get people who are a bit skinny and you put loads of makeup on and then you chisel into it and it looks ghastly. And there it is. In fact, I'd say on the mask, it probably doesn't do it justice, because it definitely goes in a lot deeper in the film. There's a huge sort of flap that's in there, which is sitting sunken down into the gory viscera. This looks great. Get on there. Go on, my boy. So, oh, for those of you that like this sort of thing, here's the tag. Dawn of the Dead. When there's no more room in hell, the dead will walk the earth. If you ask me, there's obviously no more room in hell, because judging by what's walking the streets at the moment, you know what I mean. There's in the back there. Sculpted by Alexander Ray. Trick or Treat Studios. Our little tag. Once again, cheers y'all. So what other zombies from Dawn could you do a mask of? Because they did a few from Night of the Living Dead, the original Night of the Living Dead, and I've got none of them, but they were really good as well. So I wish I got them. And obviously you've got Bub from Day of the Dead, and you've got Dr. Tongue from Day of the Dead, which I haven't got it. I stupidly never picked that mask up. Again, like I never picked this one up. But I picked it up now. So obviously, at some point, maybe I'll get Dr. Tongue as well. But at the moment, I'm really, really super happy with this guy. Again, it isn't just like, oh wow, look at the gore on that. Oh, there's a bit of skull sticking out. Oh, he's got a droopy eye. Oh God, no. But look at the realist, the lifelike quality. Even though half the face is gone, it still looks alive. Alive! Alive! Isn't it amazing? He just sticks his arm on like that. I mean, he does stand there for a second, waiting, you know, for the impact of the bullet, or, you know, the special effect to go off. And it is pretty gory as well, like, a big chunk gets blown out of him. But, look at it. Yeah, gorgeous. Aren't you? You're gorgeous, you are. You're bloody gorgeous, you are. So Paul Musser played him. I don't know if he did anything else after that at all. I mean, don't forget, everyone playing the zombies in this, a lot of the cast and crew were friends and family of the makers anyway. And they put out a big cast, just anyone in the area. Want to be a zombie for a couple of days? Just come along. So everyone just turned up like and got made up. Some would be selected to be the hero zombies, the more iconic ones, like this guy. Although, so you just even... doesn't hurt anyone. He inadvertently leads Peter to almost be shot by Stephen, but he never puts a bite on anyone at all. And in fact, most of the blood in Dawn of the Dead is from the zombies, who, as I said in previous videos, look, if you're still bleeding, that means blood is still pumping around your body. If blood's pumping around your body, your heart's beating. Your heart needs oxygen to keep beating. So that means your lungs are still working. And even, you know, they're still active unless you destroy the brain. So the brain is functioning. You've got to destroy the brain. The brain needs blood and oxygen. So you've got a working brain. You've got heart and lungs that work. You've got blood coursing through your veins. You're not dead, are you? It doesn't matter. But you're not dead though, are you? The undead. But yeah, great. That's actually pissing me off, that now. Yeah, I can work on that. Anyway, folks, there you go. The first mask review I've done for a long, long time. But I really enjoyed getting this. And I was kind of horrified when it was like in a plastic bag. And I thought, oh no. That's been kicked around sorting offices and delivery vans. Oh, Jesus. How many hands have been mangling this and booting it around and heading it, but it actually came out all right. So a little tour around it again. Yeah, that's crazy, isn't it? That terrific stuff. So folks, there you go. Trick or Treats Airport Zombie from Dawn of the Dead, aka the check shirt zombie, poster zombie, however you want to call him. Paul Musser, we salute you. Folks, I have been on with Shabby Kiltman. Please, in the meantime, this ever masquerading in between time, please keep it Kiltic, keep it Celtic, and watch out for little provincial airports. No good will come of it. No good, I tell you. And I'm going to see you all. Later! And don't stick your head up into rotor blades. Duh, what are you thinking?